Thought this stop would be a good one. It does offer a few things. And as far as diversity and bringing diversity into the system without actually using a cover crop. So, Steve, you want to elaborate a little bit on this? Or, okay.
I'll make one comment here, and then we'll check to see if others, but take a look here. You want to, one of the indicators is when we start to see a horizontal movement of a root. And so here we have a nice straight root mass. So there's an indicator that we've done some things moving in the right direction as far as building soil aggregates, taking compaction out. The other thing is there's no fertility on this field. So you basically got flax and pinto beans exchanging underneath. So you got a legume and a non-legume. And so I think we create an environment there. If you're looking at trying to reduce fertility, this might be one option. Comes with some other sideboards. We only used a grass herbicide because it's all broadleaves, so there was no broadleaf herbicide used on here. That's why you're going to see broadleaf weeds in it. So it kind of gives you some idea of what that would look like. So there's quite a bit of talk on planting two species, harvesting them as one, and then separating. But this gives kind of gives you an idea what it looks like. It's kind of our first stab at the alternate rows, like Daryl was mentioning. So
this is probably the cutting edge, maybe you might say, of regenerative agriculture growing, in a sense here, two cash crops together. And, you know, you're going to have to fit to the geographical area, what works here in North Dakota. What I have done quite successfully, and I think you could do it here if you want to grow cover crop seeds. I grow hairy vetch, winter peas, and oilseed rape together. Those three, plant them in the fall. So I guess I'm not sure if you can plant winter peas in the fall here.
You can.
Okay. Gotcha. Thanks for clarifying that. I just thought of that. Right. Get her planted. Okay. So I'm just giving you an example. This is what works for me. What's cool about that three-way mix, we can harvest it all together. We can separate those seeds out to mix them. They're designed as for cover crops. No herbicides needed, no fertilizer needed. And they grow really nicely together. The oilseed rape's primary function is to keep the vetch and the peas up off the ground so we can harvest them. So that's just an example. I know that if ever you hear of Derek Oxton from Saskatchewan, he's doing a lot of this, thousands of acres of companion cropping. That's who you want to be looking at. People around are starting to do this. I saw some in Kansas with Milo and some different beans and so forth, and they had a bunch of cover crops and beautiful flowers growing out in it too. So starting to see some of this around. You got to see what works in your area.
Justin, comments?
I'd sure like to try this, Jay. I have not been this daring. I like the cowboy side of things, which can be simpler than growing two crops and separating seed sometimes. You know, I do it all the time for forage. I grow oats and peas together. That's a no-brainer. Like Steve said, if you're getting in the cover crop seed market, why not keep a little bit of that back for seed? And there's your niche. So, but this is very cool, I think. I know there's been all kinds of farmers mentioned around, and it'll just take time to get the system tweaked for where you're at. And maybe a conversation with your crop insurance agent, too. I don't know.
There's actually data out there that shows one plant stimulates the other to hurry up the senesce part of your life. So they pretty much mature at the same time. We see that, like Derek sees that up there, we see that on our place also, that they just kind of look like they're going to be 2 weeks difference in harvest, and all of a sudden, poof, here they come. There's a fancy word for that. You probably know that word, Jay. I don't, but I read it once. We're doing lentils and flax, or chickpeas and flax.
I guess this is something I don't really have any experience with. I've seen Dave Axton and his examples. What I want to say about this type of experiment, I would call it, is this, it's one of those things that you know, we're thankful we have the Minocan farm here to try these things. You know, there's always different ways of doing things. And for most of us, you know, we look at something like this and just scratch our heads and walk away from it and never give it another thought. And it wasn't too long ago that we'd look at that field we just came from and do the same thing. And now a lot of that is common practice. So even though this might look a little odd, it might look like something we may never get into, and I'm in the same boat. I don't think I'll see it, but that's probably a fault of mine. You know, I think we have to have an open mind and, you know, look to the individuals who are doing these type of experiments like Jay and really give it a thought and consider it, you know, going forward. And it's just another step. You know, we take one small step at a time, and this is something that we might eventually get to. So.
And I've got just one more comment on the crop itself. When I was in college, I was a crop scout for 3 or 4 summers, and I checked a lot of edible bean fields. Not many were comparable to what you've got going on here. So the diversity is, it's working.
Anybody remember Nature and Property of Soils in when you might have been in college? Remember that soils book? Yeah, yeah. Yeah, the one you were supposed to read. I have it on my bookshelf. I've read it more than once. I read it once for you, Justin. But in that book, there's a diagram that Brady and Weil put in there, the authors. And it shows a legume and a non-legume plant next to each other in this diagram. And it shows something happening and moving from the non-legume to the legume. So what nutrient was that? Phosphorus. And then it showed something moving from the legume to the non-legume. What was that? Nitrogen.